Let's have a look at another FFmpeg vulnerability. Again, Paul will walk us through the vulnerability that he found together with email, and I try to understand it and add some comments, hopefully to make it a bit easier to understand.
In the previous issue, we achieved code execution quite easily. This time, we'll have to be much more accurate during exploitation. This crash was found during fuzzing the RTMP protocol. This protocol is binary, so let's open it up in my favorite hex editor called Radar 2. I like it to use when viewing the binary files, because it has a very shiny UI. Nothing too special here, just some binary data. So let me tell you something about this protocol. RTMP stands for Real-Time Messaging Protocol. Actually, it was developed by ADAP for real-time streaming of audio and video. The protocol has actually a lot of stuff inside it, and I had spent some time learning the specs before getting into the exploitation. All you need to know about the RTMP protocol so far is that it doesn't handshake first, and then it starts to transfer data in small chunks, and maximum size of each chunk is 128 bytes. Now let's dig up into the source code once again. So, after passing the version check and doing some handshake, we end up in the packet read function in RTMP packet.c. This function simply reads one byte of the header and then calls the most important function in a loop. And this is the function which does all the parsing of the protocol. There are a lot of structures, functions and allocations, and all of them are important. As you can see, each chunk has the channel ID. It is basically identifier of the RTMP packet in the array, which corresponds to its own buffer. One channel may be filled by multiple chunks, because maximum size of each chunk is 128 bytes, and packet data might be much larger. Each chunk has fields like size, type, header, timestamp, and some extra data. So, if the current channel doesn't exist yet, RTMP packet structure is filled in the array and a buffer is created for it. So, the avlog function with null pointer means simply do the allocation of the corresponding size. Otherwise, data is just filled in the existing structure and the buffer. So, if you will pay enough attention, you may notice the issue there. When the structure is filled for the second time, there is no check that the buffer size is passed for the second time is actually the same, that the size of the allocation made the first time. And this is how we will manage to get the heap overflow.
Ah, yeah, this makes sense. So the packet contains a channel ID read from the header, and if this packet was not seen before, it will allocate it with this size. But if an attacker sends the packet with the same packet ID again with a different size, it will not be reallocated. Let's visualize that. If we send a packet with ID and size hex A0, it will get allocated. And then we can send another packet with ID 2 and the size hex 80. It will get allocated after the first one. Now we send again a packet with ID 1 in a much larger size, like hex 200. Now we overflow stuff on the heap. Awesome.
So, how we are going to get the code execution? Overflowing another data chunk does not give us too much. Let's try to gather some primitives from the source code. So, we could allocate data chunk by sending new channel ID. We could overflow the chunk next to it by changing the size. And we could also trigger the reallocation inside the RTMP check alloc array function. If we send channel ID large enough, we will trigger the reallocation of the control structure, and it will be positioned right after our buffer we can overflow. By doing this little heap magic, we overflow the pointer to the data and get arbitrary write.
That's a super easy plan. We just force the reallocation of the array that contains the pointers to the data chunks, and thus the array will be allocated now after the one data packet we have. And then we send again a packet with this channel ID to overflow into this array, and thus control the address of those data chunks and can point it anywhere we want, and thus also right there.
So, I already did some preparations before and wrote a little proof of concept, because most of the work here was counting offsets. So, there are the functions I wrote. These are lambdas for packing our integers using little endian. Create payload function helps me to pack data into the RTMP protocol. And create RTMP packet function will help me to create fake RTMP structure on the heap. Now let's take a look at the main code. So, here's the handshake happens. After the handshake, I send first payload with size just a bit bigger than 80 bytes in hex, and some A's, and the channel ID number 4. I do this to create control structure on the heap. Next, I send some data with larger channel ID to trigger the reallocation of the control structure. Next, I overflow the next heap chunk, which happens to be control structure, and fix its size, so I will have no problem with the heap when I will be allocating more data. I position the fake chunk on the place of the RTMP packet with second channel ID. As you can see there, I position the real lock got PLT instead of the data pointer, so I will be able to write to it. As my last steps, I write a got PLT with some data, and after I use big channel ID once again to trigger the real lock function. All this should give us control of the RIP register. Let's see.
Super straightforward exploit, right? If you can overwrite an address in the control structure in this array, you can point it anywhere and write data to it. So here's FFmpeg in GDB with the triggered segfault.
We are jumping directly to our C's. We now have the control of the RIP register. We have successfully overwritten the gotPLT section. Achieving code execution should be easy from now on. I hope that this video motivated you a little bit and shown that real-life exploitation may be rather simple, and this will encourage you to make your own research. Good luck.
This is a really great example. Thank you so much, Paul, for sharing this with us and all the work you have put into the recording. Make sure to follow him on Twitter and check the description for some links. And don't forget to check out the podcast episode with Paul if you haven't listened to it yet.